the world's atmosphere is very, very thin. When you fly in an aircraft at 30,000, 35,000 feet, 90% or more of the atmosphere is beneath the aircraft. We're changing the composition of the atmosphere. All of the fossil fuels that we're burning put out little molecules of carbon dioxide. These molecules stay in the atmosphere. Each of these little molecules of CO2 act like a feather in a feather bed. You double the number of CO2 molecules, you double the feathers, where's the heat going? It's going to stay there. We take measurements in areas where they're not affected by local pollution. Barrow, Alaska, Trinidad Head, California, Mauna Loa, Hawaii, Samoa, South Pole, Summit, Greenland. We have people and instruments operating 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, measuring everything you can think of in the atmosphere. We measure 250 different things around the world. Probably a couple of those are just going to be important, but they might not be important for 10 years or 20 years. So we keep big cylinders of air that we take, because all of a sudden a person's going to find a chemical in the atmosphere that's doing something. Whoa, what was it like 50 years ago? Because we just see it now. Ah, we just happen to have a tank of that from 1968. So you measure it all over the world because it's changing at different places. All of the land, vegetation, people, therefore the fossil fuels we burn, are all in the northern hemisphere. But the CO2 that comes from the land and the burning eventually goes into the oceans. So we've got a study over land, over the oceans, over the poles. Eventually, if you have enough measurements, you can figure out the sources, the sinks, the rate of growth, and the rate of sinking into the ocean. Some of our data is available within minutes of our collection. Sometimes it takes weeks, but everything is out within a year, and anybody can look at it and analyze it. The carbon tracking program takes all of the carbon dioxide measurements that we make, plus the measurements from meteorology, from the forestry service, from agriculture, from ocean temperatures, from economy. All this is fed into this incredible model that puts all of this together and then relates how the meteorology moves this around. You can see the CO2 rising when there's cold temperatures in certain areas. You can see the CO2 dropping when there's rain. The idea is that eventually we'll be able to look at this model and say, okay, California, you put out 5% more carbon dioxide this month than you did the month before or a year before, or you put out 10% less. Eventually the world is probably going to say, look, okay, let's see what we can do about controlling CO2. But to do that, you've got to have the data, you've got to be able to have the predictive capability, the modeling and the tracking all in one package. And you've got to make them open to everybody.